BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
Hi, good morning or good afternoon, whenever you are watching this program. It could even be good evening. My name is Beverly Houck, and I am the Assistant Director for the Yocum Institute for Arts Education. And I'm here today to talk about a little bit about the creative process with one of our art teachers and artist, Danielle. So you can say hello, Danielle.
Hello.
Who is getting over any sort of camera shyness on the spot right now. And we'll also talk a little bit about Neighborhood Bridges, which is starting in the schools, in the Reading schools this month, as well as all of our classes that are underway. Although it is not too late to register, you can still register for many of our fall classes that are running, and Danielle will talk specifically about some of those. We have a lot of new offerings. We have many new teachers this year, which is exciting for us. A couple that started last night but will still accept new students are Cocktails and Classics, which is actually a theater class for adults, which maybe would be great for you, Danielle. You can go, you can drink wine, you can study monologues and presentation skills, and also just how to perform in theater. Samantha Clark is teaching that. That's fun. And coming up in October, we have swashbuckling for the stage and screen classes starting with Greg Ramsey, who is actually known as the king. He was the king for the Renaissance Fair for years, and
Very
he's
cool.
coming down. He even forges his own swords.
Nice.
Yeah, so he'll be bringing his own equipment.
Wonderful. Huzzah.
And we have a yoga class, which is new, which I'm excited about. But we are with your class, we might hopefully we'll get interrupted, we'll find out. With your classes, do you want to talk a little bit about when are your classes that you're teaching?
The classes I'll be teaching are Tuesdays in the evenings, ages 6 to 8 and ages 9 to 14. They're color theory classes, and so the focus is on learning about the colors of the rainbow, primary colors, tertiary colors, secondary colors. Learning about colors that sit next to each other to create a cohesive color palette, analogous colors, complementary colors, desaturation. It's exciting stuff. But we'll be doing paintings to work out our new colors that we'll be making in this class.
Great.
It should be
fun. And we have a caller. Hello, caller.
Hello, this is Miss Samantha Collins from Mr. First Class at 16th and Haak Elementary School.
Hello, Miss Samantha, I just plugged your class too.
Oh, fantastic. Come join me at Yoga.
So I understand you have a whole classroom in the background.
We do have a whole classroom, don't you guys?
Can you tell us you're at the third grade at 16th and Haak Elementary?
We are at Mrs. Kerr's third grade class at 16th and Haak Elementary.
And what were you doing this morning? Can you have a student tell us?
What were we doing this morning? Any volunteers at 16th? Tell me, Amanda. Okay. We were writing in a...
Oh, we're cutting in and out, Samantha.
Oh, can you hear me a little bit here?
Yeah, can you stay near the windows in the classroom? I think that'll help.
You got it.
Excellent. Mr. Sharp's third grade class just started Neighborhood Bridges, and they're going to have it for the whole school year. Are they excited about it?
Are we excited? I think that's a yes.
I think that's a yes. Did they like the story Miss Jenny told this morning?
Did you like the story that Miss Jenny told this morning? Excellent, excellent.
Is there anything someone might want to share?
Would anyone care to say? Just be my spirit and tell us. What would you like to share?
Miss Samantha, could you take it off of speaker while she's talking?
You got it.
Well,
hello?
Well, today I share my story, and I am finally have unity from Lego Movie, and it was so fun.
What were you doing this morning that was so fun?
We were making stories. And I added Unity from the Lego Movie into it.
So fun. Is there someone else in your class that wants to tell us something?
Yeah.
Okay. Unfiltered third graders from 16th and Haak.
Oh.
Okay. Stay near the window.
Stay near the window.
No one's there. So, Miss Beverly, right now we're asking if anyone is super excited about anything for this year, anything we did today, what we're looking forward to.
So this is Mr. Sharp's third grade class at 16th and Haak Elementary, where we started our Neighborhood Bridges program that we've been doing for 8.5 years now. Ms. Samantha, any more volunteers?
All right. So, sir, your name?
Julian.
And what are you excited about?
Acting out plays.
Great, thank you so much for volunteering. All right, we're excited about writing stories, acting out plays. We've had a great session today, and anything else, Beverly?
No, we'll see you at your, have fun at your special, and we'll see you later.
All right, thank you so much, take care.
Thanks for calling in. Well, that was really neat.
That was really neat.
That was really neat, even though the connection was a little...
They were so excited.
I don't know if they were more excited about calling into BCTV or if they were excited about about Neighborhood Bridges. But it's a program that's funded by United Way, their Ready, Set, Read program. Okay. They start with primary, basically very pre-reading skills, and then it arcs through to third grade with the Neighborhood Bridges program, which... they do creative writing, storytelling, they act out stories, and it's all connected to their language arts. And also some of their social studies, because they're learning about community and things like that. So today they had their pre-assessment, which isn't necessarily a lot of fun, except in this case it's, we try to make it fun. We tell a story, they write what they hear, and then they also got to do a pantomime game. And clearly they were having fun.
For sure. Yeah.
So what makes color, I'm jumping ahead to your classes. What makes color theory interesting to a child? Because I mean, that just sounds like a big thing, and it's, you know, and we've all heard primary and secondary colors and what that is, and even some of us have heard tertiary and, you know, the way, what was that thing where, you know, what color are you? Are you winter? Are you a summer? Remember that thing?
I don't remember that.
There was like this fashion thing that would be like, okay, you're a cool color, you're a warm color, your best colors to wear. But what are you bringing into it to make it interesting?
Well, I think it's, you know, with visual art, it's you're creating a believable space. And so I think for young painters, it's important to understand you know, the differences on how colors make you feel, what they're communicating. Art is a visual language, and the goal of arts education is to communicate. And so if, you know, the kids can understand, well, if I'm painting this fish all blue and the ocean is blue and the seaweed is green, they're communicating something with that image. If they want to paint, you know, a dragon with fire behind it and, you know, a castle in flames, they're communicating something. It's not just the dragon and the castle, it's there's energy, there's fire, there's destruction, there's all these things happening, and a lot of that has to do with their color choices. You know, and same with the fish. They could be communicating peacefulness, they could be communicating calm. It's a great way for kids to also express their emotions, to understand, you know, expressions like green with envy, or, you know, cool as a cucumber. I don't know, yeah, maybe that wouldn't be the best example, but, you know, it's an emotive way to create artworks. And, you know, the goal isn't always the end result. In arts education and in visual arts, it's also about understanding. So like you were saying, you know, with this classroom, how they're applying what they're learning to creative writing and to acting and to, they're incorporating it into many different facets of learning. And the same thing is with visual arts, where, I actually forget where I was going with that, but sounded good for a minute, and then, you know, there's a final conclusion in there somewhere. But when students are working with color, when they're working with what they are creating, they're learning more about the subject. So they're learning, oh, fish have scales. Oh, they're cold-blooded. They're learning more about fish, as well as color and design. So it's a great way to explore the world, I guess, is what that was my final conclusion. Exploration.
Yes. Well, that's what we try to do a lot of. Well, and you taught with the summer camps, too, mm-hmm. and it was called Art Exploration.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, and that was so fun. We did lots of different projects. We did space art. We painted on slate, which was fun because it's a different surface area. We painted with acrylics, with watercolors. We used oil pastel. We went outside and we did drawing in plein air. So we did a lot of different things because it was art exploration.
In fact, on our the thing we were showing, mm-hmm. that we were showing earlier, promoting our classes, one of the favorite photos of the summer is of two of the girls painting in plein air. They're right down the center there.
Yeah.
In fact, a lot of those are from summer camp and exploration, mm-hmm. but the two girls looking at the trees, what were you doing there? Do you remember?
Yeah, they were drawing, I believe it was a lantern. There was a Chinese lantern hanging from one of the trees outside the Institute, and they were drawing that. They also drew some leaves and some flowers. Those girls were great. They got really into it, and they were developing their drawings for almost 45 minutes.
It's crazy because, you know, that you look at it and you go, mm-hmm. 9 to 12:30 with,
right.
you know, six girls just doing visual mm-hmm. arts, but you had no problem filling that time.
Exactly. Once they got involved, they didn't want to stop. It was actually hard to find the break for snack time because they were doing their thing, and, you know, I hate to interrupt that process. So we had a good time. It was a good class.
Well, Danielle's classes are on Tuesdays, 5:30 to 6:30 and 6:30 to 7:30. They are two of many offerings in our visual arts department. We also have, if you're not familiar with the Institute already, we offer dance classes as well as theater, as well as music classes, including group classes in addition to private instruction. So as your school and family schedules are settling in, you know, take the time and look to see if there's something you can add to for your child or for yourself. As I mentioned, the cocktails and classics, you know, that's an adult class. And there's also adult visual arts classes mm-hmm. that are on Wednesdays primarily.
Wednesdays, abstract expressionism.
Right, and then there's also Amy Shade is doing The Artist's Way, which, are you familiar with that book?
I'm not.
There's a an art theory. I am not the expert to talk about this at all, but it's really about finding yourself through art and and just to help remove creative blocks in any art form or even just in life. Mm-hmm. And that's on Tuesday afternoons from 2 to 4. And that's also for adults. And not to forget the little ones, there are preschool just started. Welcome to preschool. And we have a few spots left in our 2-year-old early exploration class. Also something to look forward to, speaking of creative process, Inica Van Werkhoven, we're pulling out some of her artwork. She will be at the reception this coming Sunday. Her artwork will be on display through October, and she's the recipient of this year's Coggins Award, so she will be here on BCTV next month, we hope. And anyway, it's interesting because people, I'm not familiar with her work, but from what I've heard, people are much more familiar with her landscapes. But we're pulling out things that are not necessarily what you would often associate with her work, but she's an incredibly accomplished visual artist, and we're really excited to have her work on display and have her joining us this coming Sunday from 2 to 4. Hope you can make it as well. It's open to the public. All of our art openings are open to the public, and I feel like it's important to say now and then, when you see that art reception thing, mm-hmm. like years ago, you know, before I knew better, mm-hmm. you think that you're not, you're like, oh, that's for this person or person. But really.
But it's open. You want as many people there as can make it.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. And one other thing that's coming up that's important, mm-hmm. It's important to me. It's important. if you're familiar with the How I Became a Pirate book, do you know that book? How
I'm not
I Became
familiar.
A Pirate?
No.
Oh, well, we have to give you a copy for your kids.
For sure.
it's the story of Jeremy Jacob and how mm-hmm. he meets these pirates, and they take him on this wild adventure, and he becomes a pirate, but then he decides he wants to be at home because pirates don't tuck, and they don't tell bedtime stories, and they don't, and there's a sequel about mm-hmm. they don't change diapers when he has his baby sister. Yeah. This, we're doing a production of Jingle Arg the Way in November and December, and what's exciting about this is that although there isn't a book that's connected with it, it's not its own book. However, the playwright that wrote a adaptation of How I Became a Pirate, which ultimately became the only official How I Became a Pirate adaptation mm-hmm. that Melinda Long endorsed, the author of How I Became a Pirate, she did help Janet and Mark write Jingle Arg the Way. She gave her blessing and actually helped to write it. So although it's not part of the book series, it's by the author. So it's really exciting and fun. Mm-hmm. So we're going to be casting one 10 or thereabouts young man, probably looking for someone between the ages of 10, maybe 9 and 14, to play the role of Jeremy Jacob. And then we have Captain Braidbeard is coming back, who gets to meet Santa Claus, both mm-hmm. with their beards and and bellies. And we'll see how that goes. Actors, you can wear padding. You don't need to be of a particular girth to audition. And other pirates along the way. We did How I Became a Pirate years ago at the Miller Center, and it was great fun. This year we're scaling it into something smaller, more intimate for the kids at the Institute. So that's this Saturday. Wow, we really blew through everything we needed to talk about. We have 10 minutes left. So, Danielle, how did you come to the Institute? I'm just going to interview you now.
I was doing some field work for the Academy of Art in San Francisco, which is the school that I was attending, and I met with Phyllis, who's the visual arts director, and she was great. She let me tag along with some of her classes, and they were so fun. We had a really good time, and I was able to hook up with you guys and start teaching.
So. Do you remember which classes you observed now?
I observed the one at, is it John Paul II?
John Paul II Center for Special Learning.
Yeah.
Yes, and that program also started mm-hmm. this week.
That's something mm-hmm. that a lot of people aren't always aware. We talked about neighborhood mm-hmm. bridges, and you brought up John Paul, too, is
yeah.
that although we have these classes and these things going on at the Institute, mm-hmm. we have a lot that happens in the community and throughout the community.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we have visual arts classes at right. John Paul II Center mm-hmm. For Special Learning, as well as creative drama classes that started mm-hmm. earlier this week.
Yeah.
So you got to see John Paul too.
I did, yes. And then I also saw one of Shauna Hansberry's classes.
Mm-hmm.
And I went in and watched one of Rich Houck's classes. And they're excellent teachers, and they did such a great job with the kids, and I got to, you know, write a couple essays for my schoolwork, for my art education degree. And that was really great. And then one of the first classes I've done with the Institute has been over at Country Meadows. And I have to say that's actually one of my favorite classes. I have about 4 90-year-olds who are doing Christmas cards. We started in July doing Christmas cards, which is an unusual time to do Christmas cards.
But it makes sense.
But we did it.
Because you need more than one.
Exactly. Exactly. And so we've submitted our artwork for that competition. But I'm going to continue doing classes
there. Oh, there's a competition. What's
yeah.
the competition?
It's within the Country Meadows organization. They have different campuses, and so the residents get to submit their artwork, and the winning resident gets their artwork put on a Christmas card, and they get, it's dinner for 10, I believe, their choice of menu.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's so special.
Yeah,
that's
among other prizes. But
so they turned them into their own Christmas cards, though, as mm-hmm. well, right?
Yep. Well, it was just the artwork, so it was just work on a canvas that would then be digitally put on a card. So, yeah.
Well, I think between mm-hmm. you and the Institute, we can digitize it and give them a card
right.
anyway, which
for
they
sure.
probably really like to
for sure.
have.
For sure.
If
yeah.
you still have the artwork to see it, that's,
yeah.
that's the question.
Yeah.
And so... What else? What mm-hmm. talk about the different styles between like Rich and Shauna, because they're
okay.
quite
yeah.
different.
Yeah, very different styles. Let's see, Shauna. One of the things I observed in her class was that she does a lot of 3D projects. So she does a lot of sculpture. The kids were working on. They were making things out of. Newspaper and tape, and then doing plaster, and then painting on top of their sculptures.
Mm-hmm.
With Rich, he was focusing on doing a master copy of Mona Lisa. It was a value design project, and so the students were working on, you know, understanding light and shadow and value and recreating the Mona Lisa. And I think they did it with purple and white and purple and black. So it was a very interesting looking Mona Lisa. But it was neat, so you know, you could see the difference there, where one is very hands-on, a little bit messier, a little bit wilder, working with not just 2D art, but 3D art, and the other was really focused on, it was fun, because Mona Lisa was purple, but a little bit more on value theory.
That is fascinating,
yes.
because the history of Rich Houck art classes
is the opposite of that, though.
Is the opposite.
It's
which
so funny.
Which you saw full-on
yeah.
during summer camp.
Yeah. Yeah, and I've also seen him, you know, create paintings from two flights up.
oh, right, when they
yes.
drop the...
with the science experiments.
And they drop the paint-filled mm-hmm. balloons off the second-story window.
Tarp. Yeah.
And did you see the Gold Rush mining camp that was...
I did, yes. Yeah. They were staking claims out on the front property.
Yep. And he also has the art under construction class again
right,
this
right.
year, which is... he's doing it slightly differently this year, that mm-hmm. it's instead of it in the past he's done robots and things where they're taking apart things and putting
right,
things back
right.
together, and I'm sure we'll come
mm-hmm.
to do that again, but it's more of a self-guided
mm-hmm.
art under construction
yeah.
learning year.
Yeah, and I think what's neat is that each teacher has a wide range of abilities, and just depending on the lesson can really focus you know, certain aspects of what the students are creating, you know, so
yeah.
But all of the art classes at Yocum are so fun and so engaging and interactive.
And we also have Logan Toomey now, who his expertise is clay. So we've had mm-hmm. teachers in the past. It's been a few years since we've had someone that actually is their primary thing. In the past, we've had teachers that yes, they've taken some courses in clay. They know how it works. We have a kiln,
and they go too. But Logan Toomey's classes, and he's starting with younger kids too. So if you really want to learn to throw on a wheel and, you know, more hand building beyond the pinch pots that we do in many public schools do pinch pots. It's a lot of, it's really exciting to see the art department growing. Yeah. And the dance has strength and conditioning and yoga, which is new, and theater, we have almost an entirely new staff because much of our other staff has been so involved in projects around the community, which is the best reason for them not to be available to teach, although they do still come in and do things. And then in music, we have several new teachers as well. So please, please stop by the Institute. Either take a class, come to Inica's opening on Sunday, come audition for a show. Just come and see what's going on. And we look forward to seeing you hopefully at the Yocum Institute, or if not, on the Institute Presents next month. Thank you very much.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.